could have been used as an argument against Elisha, and yet he went and pleaded for Elisha. That's why his prayers were particularly successful. It's a fascinating little side note. So now we see that a person who was sinful all his life can actually regain his portion in the world to come and be counted among the righteous. How can that happen? If he repents, if he regrets,
kui sa hiirele haiget tee ära tapad, siis sa ei saa ta ka mängida, nii et ära teda haiget tee. See, just süüa teda ei plaani.
Sinned himself and caused others to sin, and that's one of the kinds of people who have no portion in the world to come. Yet, we find that there was another king who was even worse, a king called Jehoiakim. He was even more sinful than Manasseh. And yet, we're told that he has a portion in the world to come, because at his burial, it was very embarrassing or degrading experience. He was buried like a mule. It was undignified burial. And that embarrassment or that shame constituted punishment for his sins, and he thereby has a portion in the world to come, even though he was more sinful than the Russian. So we see that if a person is punished in some other way, then he retains or regains his portion in the world to come. So now the statement that the wicked have no portion in the world to come has become a very limited application. That's only if he doesn't do tshuva. It's only if he doesn't regret his sins. It's only if he doesn't have children who are gaining merit for him. And it's only if he doesn't have friends who are praying for him. And it's only if he didn't suffer any other kind. Rebbe then finds in the Talmud, the Gemara, that Menashe himself and his gang, Yeravam, they regained their portion in the world to come because many years after they had died, there was a fire in Israel, and their graves, their bodies, were consumed by the fire. Once they were consumed by the fire, their bones were consumed, then they regained their portion of the world to come, because that took the place of the excommunication from the world to come. The difference between Jehoiakim, who has a portion of the world to come, and is not mentioned in the Mishnah, and Yeravam, who is mentioned in the Mishnah as one who does not have a portion of the world to come, but regained it when his body was consumed by the fire, the difference, of course, is that until the fire, which was a couple hundred years, he was excluded from the world to come. He regained it after having lost it. So the Mishnah was correct in saying they have no portion of the world to come, because that was before the fire. Whereas Jehoiakim, at his funeral, he suffered. suffered the embarrassment. And so he never actually lost his portion of the world to come, even though he deserved it. Okay, so now we see that no matter how sinful a person is, and even if they have already lost their portion of the world to come, it is possible for them to regain it and reclaim it. Now, the Rebbe finds indication and proof, text proofs, that not only is it possible, but that it will in fact happen. That every Jew, even the most sinful, will regain their portion in the world. Where do we find that? Rambam quotes as a ruling, as a halacha, that the Torah promises that in the end of our long exile, we will repent. We will do shuv. And that will bring an end to the exile. And unless we think that that is referring to the Jewish people as a whole, but not necessarily to each individual, the Gemara quotes from the Song of Songs that the wicked and the righteous will both rejoice together because even the wicked are full of mitzvahs, like a pomegranate is full of seeds. So we see that it is not a statement about the Jewish people as a whole, but at each individual. These are the exact words where Rashi translates, even the sinful, all of them, seek godliness, they want to be close to God, and they have many merits, because even the sinful are full of mitzvahs, like a pomegranate is full of seeds. So, not only do we find that it's possible for every Jew to have a portion of the world to come, but that it actually will happen in the end of days. That's all from Talmud. Now, we also find an actual verse in Scripture, in the Torah, in Shmuel Beis, Samuel, where it says, V'choshav machshoves, God thought thoughts, planned, lebilti yidach mimeno nidach, so that even those who are rejected will not be rejected. And here's how it's worded in the halacha. Even the most sinful will eventually repent, either in this incarnation or another incarnation, because layidach mimeno nidach, the rejected will in the end not be rejected. And in Tanya, he writes that this is a certainty, that in the end everyone will do tshuva in one incarnation or another, because even the rejected cannot be lost. Now, it ever takes it a step further. Not only is it possible, not only will it happen, it must. Why must it happen? Here we go into the Kabbalah. Translate it word for word. This is an Emek HaMelech. He writes as follows. V'ata bonim, and now my sons, shimu li, listen to me. Yidas Hashem alametchem, I will teach you fear of God, v'ahavosei, and love of Him, and His love for His children. Lomba leikulahai, why does he bother with the wicked who anger him all the time, every moment? There are two answers to this question. Number one, even though they are very wicked, but there are sparks of holiness within them, and they are the plantings of God, a part of God, and every part of God is eternal. And these souls carry an impression of God Himself. Also, God is proud of His creation, of His people, and therefore, that which God makes and refers to as the work of His hands must live forever and ever and cannot disappear, cannot end. That's the first answer. The second answer is, every Jew is precious to God because of our father Avraham, who prays for every one of his descendants. Then in another place he writes as follows. When guilty yidach mimeno yidach. Even the rejected will not be lost or rejected. Why? Because God himself created the world and destroyed them. You know that concept that God created the world and destroyed them? Misunderstood. It says that God created the world and destroyed them. The meaning of it is that God created worlds that he likes, and he created worlds that he doesn't like. The world of holiness, the world of unholiness. In other words, God created life and God created darkness. And because of that, the evil in this world has become so strong that it can actually lead a person to become so sinful as to lose their portion in the world to come. But because God is the cause, he created the darkness. He created this possibility of sin. Therefore, he takes responsibility upon himself, and he sees to it that no one will be lost forever as a result of their sin. Because it's God who created sin. And that is why every Jew will have a portion of the world to come. God will not allow even the soul of even the sinful to be lost, and in the end of days, through many processes, even the sinful soul will be included or gathered in with the righteous. And that is the meaning of the verse, Va'amech kolom tzadikim, your nation are all righteous. That means that in the end they must become righteous, because God will not abandon them. This writing in the Kabbalah, which is very explicit, is based on a teaching of the Ari, where he writes, Kol Yisrael Yeshon Chevek L'Elam Haba, every Jew has a portion of the world to come. It's just that some souls will have their portion immediately, and some only at the end of time. Because God bothers, exerts himself with the sinful to fix them, to correct them. And why? Because they are his plantings and the works of his hands, and therefore